This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream and Nebula. Hey everybody, so 2 months ago, I released a video called The Cult of Dr. Phil. It seemed like you enjoyed it well enough, and I wanted to make more Phil videos, so that's what I'm gonna do right now. Talk about and explore one clip of this beautiful show. There are the same rules here as there were last time. First, I only have access to YouTube clips here, not full episodes, and so what I'm telling you might not be the full story. Second, Dr. Phil is, as always, just extremely dark. Today we'll be talking about sexual abuse, weight issues, transphobia, furries, and probably some other things that are gonna roll through the screen right now. And with that, it's Phil time, baby! Psh, 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 psh. Subscribe to my YouTube channel if you love Phil and just can't get enough! So in this video, I want to talk about a 3-minute excerpt of a conversation between Dr. Phil and someone named Boomer the Dog. Boomer, as the name would imply, likes to dress up as a dog and go around and have fun with people. He believes that there's probably some kind of dog spirit within him, that he is, to some extent, dog.
Now, you don't really think that you're part dog.
In some way, I have to believe that I am.
And as such, he goes beyond what we'd normally associate with furry culture. He sometimes eats dog food, for instance. He wanted to have his name legally changed to Boomer the Dog. In his brief talk with Boomer, Phil focuses almost all his energy on the notion that this dog man isn't experiencing the joys of life.
Is this a way of avoiding life for you in other ways?
He hasn't been on dates, doesn't have a job, doesn't have sex, etc.
You're 48, you're a virgin, right?
Yes.
You've never been on a date.
And in the final moments of the conversation, as Phil is pressing him on his lack of life experiences, his ostensibly avoidant behaviors, they have this interaction.
Yeah, well, I feel it's a good compromise for me. I mean, it's kind of a compromise to be both a dog and a human, in a way, but
yeah, beats working, right?
The video you're about to see is a simple one in some ways, because I want to convince you of just one thing. That this line that Phil says here, well, beats workin', is one of the most fascinating and revealing things I've seen on this show. But to convince you of that, we're gonna have to go on a little trip through the land of Dr. Phil, explore how it generally works and what it often seeks to accomplish. So let's get started with all that. If we blur our eyes and look at Dr. Phil as a whole, what jumps out at us? Like, on a mechanical level, what is this show about? Well, here's how I'd answer. Dr. Phil is a show about the powerful, almost magnetic relationship between a problem and its solution. And let me explain what I mean. There's a conversation on the Dr. Phil channel between Phil and a guy named David. David is very fat, over 650 pounds, and he hates it. He feels his life is out of control, he has mobility issues, and he's worried about dying prematurely.
Every day, I listen to see if he's gonna get up. Because if he gets up, I'll hear him, and then I thank God because he's alive for today.
There's a lot of things that happen during this talk. Phil gets to the bottom of these weight issues, talks to David about his childhood experiences of molestation and bullying. He shames David's father for not being able to completely control his mature son's diet, and scolds him because he had the gall to laugh about his son drinking a soda at one point.
Pepsi and there's another bottle down here, but I'm sticking my hand in there. I don't know what's on there.
That's a terrible laugh, but, you know, that's his stash. He's like a drug addict.
And my question is, how is that funny to you? There's nothing in the world we can do with you if everybody around you is sabotaging you.
But when you cut all this backstory and all this random nonsense out, what are you left with? Well, we've got a problem and a solution, and they're both really simple. The problem is David's too fat, and the solution is just the negation of the problem. David has to lose weight and do things that would be conducive to that end. The sheer simplicity of this solution is made clear with one of the funniest lines in the episode.
Willpower is a myth. It's fickle. When you're all gung-ho and fired up, then you're great. The time that you need to be on task is when you don't feel like it, when you don't feel fired up, when you don't have the energy to get up and do the things you need to do. That's when you need to stick with it the most, and that's where willpower lets you down.
No, Phil explains, willpower doesn't work. You need to do the work even when you don't have the energy. Like, you have to push through your lack of motivation and do what's right for your body. You know what I mean. It's not willpower. Willpower is stupid as fuck, but you just have to do it. You know what I mean? You just have to get through it and get thin. It's not willpower, though. It's completely unrelated. Willpower's over here, and what I'm talking about is way over here. They are two completely different ideas. This one dumb, this one smart as hell. My point here is that nothing Phil says, no matter how smart and important he tries to make it sound, really goes beyond get less fat, David. Does it matter in this episode that losing lots of weight like this is extraordinarily difficult? Does it matter that Phil has offered the most worthless advice of all time? When you're not motivated, that's when you need to be motivated. No, of course not, and how could it? This is a case where the medium is the message, right? Dr. Phil is a short show. We get a few minutes with each of these people, and we don't have time to go through options or check in on these people. These things, by necessity, have to be left to the outside of the show. They'll hook him up with a trainer, find him a therapist, I guess.
So there has to be a therapeutic component to this in addition to everything that Robert offers here.
The real work happens when we are not in the room. So my point here isn't just to blindly judge everything about this show. Nobody actually believes that huge life-altering problems can be solved here, and that's fine. But I do want to make a case here that this intuitive relationship between problem and solution, you're too fat, so be less fat, functions to give Dr. Phil a lot of power. It looks extremely simple, almost mindless, and because of that, it conceals a pattern of underlying assumptions that pervade this show and allow Phil to pursue a very particular ideological project. So we could talk about David more now, but I think it's probably best if we move on to another, more complicated example, Brandon. Brandon is 35, unemployed, and still living with his parents.
My son Brandon is a moocher. He is lazy, refuses to get a job.
He's never been able to hold on to a job for long, and he wants jobs making movies, something that he hasn't been able to get a foothold in.
Brandon raps everywhere. He'll bust out a rap anywhere you are.
Like a soap on a rope, boy, I'm hard to touch.
And during this conversation with Phil, we can see the same dynamic cropping up that we saw with David. The problem in this situation is, of course, everything I just said. Brandon doesn't have a job, still lives at home, etc. And the solution, as we've now come to expect, is to do not that stuff. Brandon has to straighten up and fly right. He has to fend for himself.
How do they know you have talent? Show me something.
How do I get there, Dr.
Well, show me something. Show me something you've accomplished.
How do I get there?
In the morning.
But there's an issue here, and a pretty fundamental one. Put simply, none of this can possibly work. See, Brandon has a lot of issues that he discusses in these clips. He talks about going into manic episodes where he feels he can do anything. He talks about the flip side of this mania, total fatigue, energy loss, depression for days.
The other spectrum of this mania that I go through is a severe, severe depression where I'm not doing any of that creative stuff. I'm in my room stuck in there and stuck to all of these thoughts and all of these creations and miserable.
He specifically talks about feeling like there's a monster inside of him. It's pretty intense, honestly.
And there's a monster dwelling inside here.
Now, I think we can all agree, given this, that Brandon's lack of employment, his living at home, it just can't really be solved through some simple negation. There's no just getting out of it. Like, it is almost impossible to be productive and methodical when you find it genuinely impossible to control your mind, to gain control of your sleeping, to prevent yourself from vacillating between manic creative episodes and intense depressive ones.
I don't know how to control my mind. It's creative. I don't know how to control my sleep patterns. I don't know how to fix a lot of things that I believe are broken inside of me.
Dr. Phil does acknowledge all of this, kind of. When Brandon's father says, I think there's something wrong with him, Dr. Phil says, yeah, we'll look into all that. Get him checked out.
I think there's something seriously wrong. I don't think it's just...
That may be. And no. if he does have a mental illness, then I want to try to figure that right. out. Figure out what it is, and right. we'll
so
figure out what
not
to do.
To repeat.
But all of this can only exist as a hand wave, a hint at some potential future activity because, you know, it can't compromise the all-important mission of explaining to Brandon that he's unqualified for the jobs he wants.
Why should somebody let you just walk in off the street and start telling a DP when to push in or not push in or whatever? Why should somebody do that? Why?
We can't get in the way of the essential task of telling this guy, someone who sometimes sleeps for 20 hours in a day, that he needs to wake up for work.
Well, show me something. Show me something you've accomplished.
How do I get there? I mean, I...
You wake up in the morning.
Yeah, I think he's probably figured that one out, Phil. I think he's probably... put those pieces together. In this case, we can see very plainly how the model of Dr. Phil's show, the way he picks a problem and just says it should be solved, basically works as the delivery mechanism for his agenda. Everything Phil says is true, it's plausible. Brandon should wake up on time and work to do what he wants to do with his life. We all agree fundamentally, and this agreement obscures one basic fact. That Dr. Phil chose the problem. He's stacking the deck. You know, if I were looking at this situation, not as a therapist, but as the human being that I am, I wouldn't say that the problem here is that this guy doesn't work. I'd say it's that he's miserable, that he clearly has some undiagnosed issues, and that his inability to work is just one of many symptoms of that. But through Phil, we come to understand Brandon not as a person, but as a failed career, a job undone. Because before he ever stepped foot on that stage, we already had our vision narrowed to one conflict and one resolution, one that we can all take to heart. Your bootstraps haven't been pulled, and considering that, you should probably pull them. One last really simple example, one that kinda cements my case. A conversation between Phil and a girl named Diamond. Diamond is a trans woman who's been acting out. I don't want to get too in the weeds on this because it honestly doesn't matter at all, but suffice it to say, her family and mother think she's manipulative, toxic, attention-seeking, entitled, etc.
Diamond is irresponsible, careless, and unempathetic.
Already here, we have our obvious problem and solution that will pervade the episode. Diamond is bad, Diamond should be better, and people should stop accepting how bad Diamond is. Pretty standard stuff. The interesting thing, though, is Diamond's brother, Mitch. Mitch is pretty aggressively transphobic. He claims that he doesn't have any kind of problem with Diamond transitioning, but he absolutely refuses to gender her properly, claiming that Diamond will always be his brother.
I don't have a problem with him being transgender. He's still my brother, that's why I call him my brother and call him Brandon.
Diamond has a kind of sad story. When she was 16, she wore a face mask for around a year because she couldn't stand people looking at her pre-transition.
I started wearing sunglasses because I felt like I was hidden away. I eventually started just wearing that with a hoodie, and then it got worse, and then I started wearing like a shield.
And so, her brother treating her like this, constantly engaging with her as a man and facing no resistance from his family, I don't know, it's very obviously troubling, right?
He needs to learn some respect for other people, including me.
Now, I want to be careful here. I cannot figure out anybody's issues over the internet. In fact, I'm not qualified to do that, not on the internet. And I'm not saying here that I I know that Mitch's transphobia is the proximate cause of anything. Rather, the reason why I bring all of this up is because the episode gives us no tools to make sense of this aspect of Diamond's life. While we do get a few bits of info from various interviews that I've already shown, as far as the conversation between Phil and Diamond and Diamond's family is concerned, we just do not talk about it. Instead, the conversation is wholly about Diamond being an asshole and about people telling her not to be an asshole. In fact, Mitch is constantly positioned in the role of the reasonable common sense man.
And what you're doing right now is nowhere near okay. Look at what you're doing right now.
Phil asks him limply if he has some problem with Diamond's transition.
Your brother wants to transition to being a female. That's not your issue.
He says no, not at all, in this all too innocent tone.
Not a problem at all, no.
And then Phil just jumps right into Mitch's corner.
Your issue is being a user, a taker, an exploiter, and not being a responsible, pull your own weight citizen. That's your issue, right?
Exactly. He treats our mom like crap.
These are the reasons you resent your sister, right? That she's so awful. Nobody ever asks Diamond how she feels about the constant misgendering. While we obviously don't have the full episode here, it seems like he never even asks her about her transition, about her experiences growing up in this family. His lack of basic interest in her life is genuinely blinding. All this to say, yeah, the world of Dr. Phil is composed of two things, a problem and its implied solution. And in this regard, Phil takes a stance, even though he never comes right out and says it. To him, Diamond is irrelevant. Being trans is irrelevant. Transphobia is irrelevant. Society is irrelevant. Personal history is irrelevant. You are broken, and now it's time to get fixed, and that's all we have to say. And so, finally, we return to Boomer the dog. Did you forget about him? Did you forget about this dog? I sure didn't. I wrote this video, baby. I am in complete control of this situation. It has all been leading up to this, baby. Fucking strap on your goddamn seatbelts, because we're talking about Boomer the fucking dog! Okay, considering... Okay, considering everything I've said thus far, and looking at Boomer, we might be able to immediately spot the issue that Dr. Phil is going to have in this situation. Boomer is fine. Like, this guy is just out there, right? He likes to wear costumes. He likes to vibe around the neighborhood. I'm not saying here that Boomer's lifestyle is for everyone. God knows I'd rather die than chow down on a big can of dog food. The very idea of it sends shivers down my spine, in fact. But, you know, that's Boomer's call. He seems like a nice enough guy, and he seems fine with where his life is. So, what is Dr. Phil supposed to do with that? Well, he starts by grasping wildly at straws, trying to fabricate problems in Boomer's life so he can tell Boomer to solve them.
You're 48, you're a virgin, right?
Yes.
You've never been on a date, you don't have a job, you just put on a paper dog suit and walk around town, which doesn't seem to me to be a highly productive course in life.
You don't go on dates. You don't have a ton of friends. You don't have sex, do you, Boomer? You've never even had sex once, have you? This sort of interrogation just kind of bounces off of Boomer, though. Even Phil's claim that Boomer's belief he's a dog is some delusion doesn't really land.
People have said, that it might be a fantasy that I have in the past.
Yeah, people have said that, he admits, but it doesn't add up to anything. Boomer's mood, his positive vibes, his faith in his doghood. These things aren't going anywhere, and he doesn't want them to. So, in the end, Phil does just kinda give up.
You're missing an awful lot of life, which is, if you make a conscious choice to do that, then so be it.
You're missing a lot of life, but if that's what you wanna do, go for it. There's nothing really left to say, and so Phil stops. But right as the interview ends, Phil says one last sentence. The words this entire video is about.
I mean, it's kind of a compromise to be both a dog and a human, in a way, but
yeah, beats working, right?
Yeah, beats working, right? You know, just looking at this line literally, what Phil's saying here is true, almost self-evidently true. Boomer certainly does prefer to do this dog thing than to do labor that's productive for capital. If he didn't, he wouldn't have made the choices he made. He wouldn't be Boomer. But so what? So what? It's better than working. Lots of things are better than working for lots of people. Why is Phil saying that line like it means anything? Well, the reason is quite obvious, I think. This is one last jab from Dr. Phil. Phil loves work, right? And he hates laziness. That is a very common theme on the show, and it can be seen throughout the clips we've talked about today. From David to Brandon to Diamond.
You've never had a job.
No.
And so, him saying beats working is a judgment. It is a mark against him, and you can hear that in his tone. You are living off of your mom's money. You're not working, you're avoiding the real world, you haven't had sex, and that kinda sucks. You know, I love this moment with Boomer the dog because in some sense, it unmasks the entire show, right? Like, Dr. Phil gains a lot of mainstream appeal, a lot of influence through the simple fact that he does not make explicit political claims. Phil doesn't explicitly say awful things about trans people. He seems to have okay beliefs about them.
Thereby, as some people have described it, defining transgender individuals out of existence.
Where does that come from? You think just, I'm gonna change the word, I'm gonna take that out of the dictionary, and these people seek to exist? Kiss my ass, you can't do that.
He doesn't deny the importance of people's circumstances or their mental illnesses. If there's one thing that's good about this show, it's that he has destigmatized mental issues, at least to some extent. Phil doesn't say that we should shame fat people or that not being able to lose weight is some kind of easily resolved personal failure. No. The show just kind of performs those messages. And it does so, not through positive political statements, but through a series of exclusions. We are not here to talk about solving your obvious mental illness. We're here to talk about how shitty you are and how you need to get better if you want a job. We're not here to talk about transphobia or your identity. We're here to talk about how shitty you are and how you need to get better so as to stop being shitty. The show does not tell us what to believe. It simply puts us on a train whose terminus is always some kind of irritating scolding. You do bad thing, and since that's the only thing we care about, our only advice can be stop doing bad thing. And in that situation, the whole show can feel so natural. This is just what Dr. Phil is here to do, right? The show doesn't have an agenda, doesn't want for anything. It is merely the exercise of its mechanics. But what Boomer tells us more clearly than any other moment is that this is not true. Dr. Phil doesn't like the way Boomer lives his life. He doesn't have sex, he sometimes eats dog food, and most importantly, he does not work.
In a way, but
yeah, beats working, right?
And looking at the way Phil handles this situation, you realize that he isn't just some kind of robot who tells people about their obvious issues. He never was. He is doing something here, trying to get us to believe something. He's telling us about how people should and shouldn't live their lives, about how not working is a moral transgression, about his narrow conception of personal responsibility, and about what normal looks like and how it must be maintained. These ideas must come through, no matter what. It is the point of the work. And in the absence of any real problem, anything that Phil can limply pick at and tell people that they should solve, Phil's issue must be with happiness itself. Boomer enjoys his life, And that's the problem. So I know what you're thinking right now. Wow, I sure did love watching Big Joel talk about Dr. Phil, but now I don't know what to do with myself. Like, where do I go from here? What's next? And that's why I'm genuinely excited to talk about my partnership with the streaming service Nebula. Every month for the foreseeable future, I'm going to be releasing an extra video for Nebula. So for instance, this month, I have a video where I just discuss one of the strangest Dr. Phil conversations in existence. One between Phil and an absolute legend named Orin the Cyborg.
Mother, just come down. You are disturbing our operations. Listen, listen, we are receiving programming. Down. We are watching video. We are learning.
I think it's a pretty fun time. Personally, these videos can be released to the public after a while, usually like a year, but they probably won't all be, since they're not always algorithm friendly or probably good for my channel. Honestly, I just love releasing dumb little videos, and so I'm excited to have an outlet for these dark energies inside of me. The whole thing is pretty cool. With a subscription to CuriosityStream where you can watch great nature documentaries I really like this one where David Attenborough talks about hummingbirds, you also get access to Nebula, where you get my videos early, the bonus videos I talked about, and access to tons of other stuff. Bonus vids from Lindsay Ellis, Sarah Z, Tom Scott, and people like that. It's pretty cheap and on discount right now. For less than $15, you get a year of access to the whole thing. So if you're interested in any of that, sign up at the link in the description, CuriosityStream.com/BigJoel. So that's the end of the video. Like, comment, and subscribe. And if you really liked it, feel free to check out my Patreon. Just so you know, you get all of the Nebula videos I talked about on there too. I didn't want to make you feel like you were getting ripped off or whatever. So with that, now it's time for my Patreon question of the video. Alice M asks, do you vape? And if so, what is your vape of choice? Well, this is a bit of an interesting question because yes, I vape. And I just got a new vape. I was using Juuls for a while, but A, they're a huge ripoff, and B, I'm trying to lower my dependence on nicotine. So I recently went down to the vape store and got two vapes, just like this. One of them I'm filling with nicotine juice, and one of them it's just regular vape juice. That way I can transition my physical addiction into a psychological one over time, hopefully. Kind of an in-depth answer there. I hope some happy vapor got some insight. And with that, thank you so much to everybody. Thanks for... bye.